Awesome. I didn't look. I don't want to look at myself. I didn't know it was going to be that big. I thought they'd put it on the website somewhere. Yeah, practice TDD. It's really difficult to see the folks, but I'm still going to try to see how many people are actually creating a unit test. Just raise your hands. I can't see that. Oh, not that much, actually. Who's still programming? Just to verify that I'm talking to the right audience. A lot of people are afraid to raise their hands or their managers or something. I don't know. Are you going to be telling your developers after the session how to do it correctly? I've shot myself in the foot many times. I'm willing to admit I might be still shooting myself in the foot. But yeah, I'm learning every day. At least I'm trying to do that. Somebody called this the ego slide. I'm again, really big, but I call myself the continuous improver. That's why I'm saying I'm learning still every day. And that's my Twitter handler. I have a couple of open source projects, a blog, all kinds of stuff you don't really care about. So let's talk about a unit test. Did I go quick enough over my own slides? Yeah. What is a unit test? I think if you ask any developer, you probably get like 10 developers, 10 different opinions, right? I can see that. I've seen it myself. So I decided to do my own opinionated definition, just to make sure that we set the stage here correctly. So unit test is fast. Yeah, can imagine. 50 milliseconds. I don't know if that's fast enough. It's kind of arbitrary, but you know, fast is fast. Especially if your code base has something like, I don't know, 2,000 or 10,000 unit tests, you don't want to wait for 10 minutes or half an hour just to get them green. There, your feedback loop is really important. They run in memory. That kind of comes with this fast thing. Stuff that doesn't run in memory is usually not that fast, I would say, at least not on my machine. It has no I/O bound dependency, so it does not use, I don't know, network I/O, disk I/O. Even though disks have become really fast these days, it becomes kind of a gray area, I can say, because yeah, still you can even run a database like on your local machine or in memory these days. But try not to have any I/O bound dependencies. That's really a good starting point. Has no static dependencies. You know, if anybody run a unit test and it runs fine, it's green, and then you run the whole batch and everything is still green, and then you run all 100 of them, and then suddenly some of them start to fail. You know, and then like, oh crap, what's going on? Can I, what did I do wrong? Did I something wrong? Then you run that one failing unit test and it's green again. Like, huh? And you try again and it's green, and then you run all 100 of them and again, everything fails or randomly fails, even worse. This is usually a sign of relying on something called static mutable state. Stuff that is being shared between your tests. Don't do that, ever. Even though if you're programming in Java or C#, you have this nice static thing that you can use so that you don't have to use dependency injection, it's really bad. It leads you into the dark side. Causes no side effects. Well, that's kind of related to this whole static things. No side effects. You don't want your test to affect the other test because it's going to hurt. It's going to lead you in these weird situations that you want to avoid. Should be parallelizable. It's a nice exercise. If you're in the .NET space like I am, and you've invested in unit tests for like a couple of years and you use something that Microsoft ships out of the box, all your tests run sequentially. And we're in a happy world. Everything is fine. Then you switch to a unit test framework that runs everything in parallel. And then shit hits the fan. Because stuff starts to fail for unexplainable reasons. So we should be running them in parallel by default because it will surface all these weird static and, you know, static mutable state related things, maybe threading related things that you didn't think about or didn't experience before. That is really important. Make them parallelizable. It can be run in any order. Goes without saying, right? These are open doors. I'm not telling you anything new, I hope. But for some reason, I run into code bases that violate either all of them or at least 90% of those principles or guidelines. I mean, it's just my opinion, but it's my own pain I'm sharing here. That's what I'm doing. Can be run in any order. All right. So, test-driven development. Did anybody join the session this morning about what's called strategic test-driven development? A couple of people. It was quite interesting because the presenter, the Italian guy, was kind of providing a holistic view on testing stuff. Well, for me, test-driven development doesn't mean exactly what the book says. It all starts with number two, which is weird. Actually, I meant number one first. I didn't create a unit test for this. Design the class responsibilities. Nobody starts coding without thinking up front about what are the different, you know, objects or concepts in my system, how they work together. Nobody starts just creating like, okay, I'm now going to create a test without thinking about what are the classes in my design. You think about it. You think about the boundaries. You think about how to decouple certain elements from each other. You all apply solid, obviously. You know, I'm clean code, all this stuff. So you don't start with the unit test. And then you write a unit test based on what I just described. Start with the classes, start with the big design, and the big design is going to change. I can promise you, nothing is, at least I'm incapable of designing something first time right. I have not actually met anybody who can do that, but you write a first unit test. Then you generate your steps. That's how it works, kind of. Eh? You create these empty implementations, and then you know, make sure that the test fails for the right reason. Again, sounds like an open door, but if you really think about it, how often have you actually found a bug in production, tried to create a unit test to reproduce it, and forgot to actually check that it failed for the right reason? Because it might actually fail for the wrong reason. You need to be explicit. I typically just change the production code a bit to verify that I have a failing test to reproduce a particular scenario before I fix the problem and make the test green. See that as a separate thing. It's a kind of a validation. Then you implement the real deal, and you ensure that the test succeeds, the red-green refactor. And then you think about alternative scenarios. There was some great advice from the other presenter. But this is kind of, it's not about the test itself. It's design-driven. You think about the test, and you use the test to identify scenarios. And then you use those scenarios to come up with alternative scenarios. That is the real power of TDD. It's not about writing tests. It's not about, you know, annoying people that they have to create unit tests for everything, because that's how a lot of people see it. And then you repeat it twice. Why twice? I don't know. Usually I don't refactor until I've seen something three times. I mean, twice is coincidence. Three times, you might say, it's a pattern. So I don't refactor immediately. I start to, you know, redesign my code, add more tests, and then I discover, like, hey, maybe I can actually refactor this in a more nicer way. Refactor. That's what it is. Not red-green refactor. It's much more complicated. Forget about all the books. Remember this part. Because if you start doing the books, you're going to shoot yourself in the foot. You get all these small unit tests that break whenever you start to redesign your code base. So a couple of principles of great unit tests. It's a bit presumptuous, but yeah, I mean, is this the things I discovered myself, and they seem to work for me. I just hope they work also for you folks. No black box, no white box. What does that mean? So black box would mean that you would treat the code you're testing as a black box, I don't know, as something that hides the internals. So you're going to maybe write, like, academically prove that every combination is valid. So if you have a method called add that adds 4 and 6, you know, then you create a test like 4 and 6 results in 10. Do you then really have to create a test that says, like, if you have 2 and 8, it also results in 10? You could do that, but it's pretty expensive. White box is kind of trying to use some internals. You're going to hook into the internals of your code to verify that your test is working. You don't want to do that either. You don't want to use backdoors and stuff. It's not entirely something you can avoid, but you want to avoid that as much as possible. I call it kind of gray box. I might not even invent this myself. I'm pretty sure I didn't. So I do use the knowledge about how something is implemented in my tests. So I do consider the amount of paths through my code base in my tests. But I don't have to, you know, there's never a goal to have 100% code coverage. That's complete bullshit. I'm not sure if I can say that, but yeah. But it is. If somebody, if a manager tells you, yeah, we have SonarQube, I want you to reach 100% in next release, call him BS. Because it doesn't work like that. The world is not perfect. Test at the right scope, and we'll talk about this, because this is the single most difficult thing in writing unit tests. Finding the right scope. This is what you're going to be struggling with, if you're not already struggling with that. If it's not important for tests, it's very important to hide that. Anybody who knows who this is? Scooter. Yes, Scooter. Yeah, he has a song, like, he says something like, it's nice to be important, and it's important to be nice. And I called this thing, and then some of my colleagues started to call me Scooter. I don't even look like he's much thinner than me. But this is important. If something is not important for a test, make sure you hide it. Because your tests are not just tests. Your test should be documentation. They describe how your system is supposed to work. They're not just a safety net, they're a part of your code. They're first class citizens of your code base. Crystal clear cause and effect. So it should be very obvious what is the entry point of your test, what is it trying to, what's the context that it creates, what's the action you execute, and then what's the assertion that happens at the end. You really want to make that clear, and I'll show you in a couple of minutes some examples or an example. It reads like a book. Who doesn't want a test that reads like a book? And this is something from Clean Code as well. The Clean Code, Robert C. Martin wrote that book. He wants you to look at your code and be able to read from top to bottom. Nobody likes to jump around all the time, you know? Scroll up and down, like, where am I? Oh, I'm now here. No, you want to read from top to bottom what's happening. I see some people like, what the hell is he talking about? You copy three times before you refactor. This is what I just showed you as well. I don't apply dry in the way I used to. Dry, don't repeat yourself, is a good thing, but it's one of those tools that you can also cause yourself to shoot in the foot, because applying dry can also create unnecessary coupling. For my tests, I try to avoid dry. I keep my test as wet as possible, I don't know. But the point being is, just copy a test, copy another test, don't introduce base classes or something like that. It's only going to make the thing much more difficult to reason about. And I don't know if you recognize that, I'm kind of against inheritance and that kind of concept. People create a base class because they think they're reusing something. And it starts always like, you know, it's benevolent. You're trying to create your code, to refactor it a bit. But then there's a fifth test, and they need to change the context a bit. And then your base class suddenly becomes a monster where you have to hook into all the points in time. Just copy the damn thing. It's perfectly fine to do that. Avoid dry, I mentioned it already. And acknowledge the dependency inversion principle. Who's actually using who's using Solid on his day-to-day job? What is Solid? I see people ask. Yeah, it's a couple of principles, but I'll explain this one. This is the D in Solid, dependency inversion principle. So instead of having something called an order processing module that is somewhere in your domain and it depends on an implementation detail called iStoreOrder, which is somewhere in your data layer, which is the bottom of your architecture, and you have some kind of generic thing, a repository, because you read the DDD book and it talks about repository pattern, you just applied it. These things also typically lead to what some people call a mocking world, like over-mocking, using fakes and stubs. Because if you want to test your order processing module, you probably have to, I don't know, fake the interfaces you depend on, and that leads into really ugly tests. Instead, what you do is you build a module and saying this module defines a contract towards the rest of the system. And then you can still use mocking if you want to, but it will be really specific. So technically, if you would look at the code and not really think about ownership and functionality, it's basically the same thing. I have a class depending on the interface and an implementation of that interface. But there's a subtle difference here. It's the color. The interface is specific, designed for the order processing module. If another module needs something else or something similar, it will define its own contract. So the contract evolves with the owner, which is the domain in this case. The blue part is the domain if you're not colorblind. The underlying implementation, the orange one, is there to implement those interfaces. If you take this on a really big scale, you draw like an architecture like that, you end up with an onion architecture. Maybe you've seen that. Or hexagon architecture, similar concept. It's beautiful. If you practice this thing already, your test will look really different. It will also be much clearer how things are related to each other. So defining the scope of testing. That's also an interesting one, because that's the most difficult one, as I said before. So I don't know if there's any C# developers here in this room, but this is an example of a unit test, or a little piece of a unit test. It's actually a library. And that library allows you to compare two object graphs. In this case, some kind of collection of events that have happened, and we compare that to an array of anonymous types, and it really cares about the order. At least that's how I read this. This is a library. It's not really important what the library itself is, but the point is, this is a piece of functionality that has an implementation. This method called beEquivalentTo is actually pretty complicated, because it looks like this. Anybody can still read UML these days? I don't know. Is this something from the past? Or well, this is, I mean, it's not even that important, but you will find stuff like a validator depends on an I equivalency step. And there's a lot of these steps that do all kinds of stuff, comparing dictionaries, comparing collections in a fuzzy way. There's a lot of stuff there, all kinds of options to the right side. But the point being is, this looks like a lot of code. There's a lot of classes in this picture. How do you test that? If you read a book about TDD, they probably tell you to test this thing separately. Of course, a unit is a class, right? That's how we've been taught. Or maybe, where's the other one? Test the dictionary equivalent step separately, because it's already a pretty complicated class on itself. I prefer to test the whole thing as one thing. Oh, I was actually going to show more things. I look at this thing as, this whole thing just serves one purpose. Every piece in this picture is just an implementation detail of a bigger thing. Why would I test the internals? I'm testing the big thing. And in this case, it was really easy because the code that you just saw was everything you need to be able to test this whole thing. Of course, there will be lots of different tests that cover different parts of the feature set. And you can use a coverage tool to see how far you get there. And I did actually evolve this code base by writing unit tests because I do practice TDD. But the code didn't start like that. It started as one single class and evolved over time. And then I thought like, hey, it's becoming a God class. I need to refactor this. And I did that without rewriting any tests, because that's the whole point. And this is what I'm trying to say. Think about the scope in your code base. Try to find the boundaries, make them explicit, and treat that as the unit. Make sense? I'll be around for questions and complaints. Other example, a bit more complicated. I have an app, and the app sends a command to something called a command handler. And that command handler eventually looks up a domain model. And the domain model stores something called events, representing what happens in a domain. It's called event sourcing. In something, it's called an event store. And those are eventually stored in a database. This is one side of the story. By the way, this is an architecture style, and you cannot query on this data. It's all stored as a single table or a single list of everything that ever happened in this system. So you cannot answer any functional questions here. So what typically happens is you have another side. It's called an API controller. In this case, it's like an HTTP endpoint, a REST endpoint. I should have renamed this. And the app calls that. And then we have something that listens to these events. And these events represent things that happened in a domain and projects them into a structure that is more readable, called a projection. So if you have a list of documents or like legal documents that need to be signed and you want to be able to show me a list of all signatures set by a particular person, you'll need to create a specific projection that takes those events and stores them into something that looks like a real database. And it can be a NoSQL solution or something like that. This is command query responsibility segregation, CQRS. Some people may have recognized that. And event sourcing. Not that important. But what's important is, how do you test this? I mean, you're building a complicated system. There's a lot of complexity. How do you test that? Well, maybe you're going to test this REST endpoint directly. But yeah, that REST endpoint is just an implementation detail. Are you really going to create an instance of that class and invoke it? Or maybe this part, the projections. You know, you create an instance of your projector in a unit test, call a method called a projector and pass in an event and see if it was updated. I think we can actually do this whole thing. Look at this whole box as a boundary, as a unit in unit testing. Because everything in this picture, all the little the red boxes and the yellow box, in this boundary, is an implementation detail of how to query on something that is based on a list of events, things that happened. Events are users created, a document was signed. So that's a pretty big unit. And of course, at the beginning, I said like you should not have any I/O bound, you know, dependency. A database looks like I/O bound. However, we have these cool databases these days that you can run in memory, and they're really fast. Why would you abstract away a database if you can just use it directly? You cannot do that. You can't abstract it away. But there's a big chance that in production you eventually run into some kind of weird issue because you didn't actually test the database as part of your unit test. You can debate whether it's a unit test or it's actually really integration test. I tend to lean towards a unit test. But All right, some code to show you some examples I don't like. It's in C sharp. I hope if you program in different languages, you still, it still kind of makes sense what I'm saying. I have a test, and this test, yeah, what does it do? It says something when a state transition event is applied. I have to scroll it because the name is very long. To a document, what is a document count projection? The controller should return one active document. Okay, it's a pretty long name. It's probably self-describing, but there's one problem. It's really technical. So if I have a failing unit test, what I do is I first look at the title of the test. What is this thing trying to accomplish from a functional perspective? That is really important because that gives me an indication of what is the code going to look like? What kind of code can I expect? Then I look at the implementation. If the implementation makes sense, then I know, like, okay, this is probably really a product issue. By the way, all the slides and code is already on the internet, so you can already download it. You don't have to make pictures. Now, what does it do else? It does something with an in-memory event source here. Yes, mama. And then it creates, I don't know, in-memory NoSQL database, and then it defines a lot of constants. I don't like these constants, though. I would get rid of them. Why? Because they make your test longer. And do I really have to define country name? Why don't I just use Netherlands or filming and use it everywhere? Okay, then it creates an in-memory database and starts to write stuff. It's write the stuff in this, directly into this database here. It's trying to hack it in. And then it stores this into the database, and then it does all kinds of magic stuff, which I can't read either. Probably to spin up an actual REST endpoint in a unit test. You can do that in .NET. And then it creates a client and does some more stuff. And then it's writing a state transition event, which is something from the domain in this case. It's a something that is representing a transition that happened from a particular document. And then it's doing some HTTP, I don't know, gets, I suppose. It's called get async with a URL with some variables that are injected. And then it does more stuff, all kinds of magic. And I actually lost track already. Anybody still following it? I don't expect that because I lost track. There's a lot of stuff going on just to be able to test this box. So you wonder, why the hell did you create a test like that? Because I like it's a unit, but we can do some good stuff. Let me give you, oh yeah, this also really doesn't help. I mean, so it's apparently doing a GET request and it receives a JSON blob, which we have to parse into I don't know what. And then we verify that the country code is has a certain value. Which country code? That's the constant I defined up front. And some more stuff. Yeah. It is that I've actually looked at this test many times that I kind of know what it does. But I have to scroll up and down. Of course, I can also reduce the font to like 6 and it will fit on one screen. Maybe that solves the problem. Not really. No. So let me try an alternative implementation. What is this? So now it's called when a document is activated. Okay, activated still feels like a developer invented this name, but maybe a document is indeed activated. And we use a structure called a given when then. This feels more like it's more like the BDD style. It is definitely not behavior-driven development because there's no business people involved. I wonder if anybody actually has practiced BDD with business people. And the rest, yeah, it looks a bit different because now we are storing not just directly a projection, but we're using something called a builder. I like that model. It's actually what we call a test data builder. And it's a nice little pattern that allows you to have an object that you can use to build other objects. And you only have to specify the things that are relevant. The idea is that if you call this document count projection builder with just .build, it will give you an object that is valid according to the domain. May not be valid in every business rule, but it gives you a good starting point. It's one of the little tricks to help you focus on the things that are important for your tests. Just something to remember. I'm using a little library that also allows me to store some stuff, like I can set the iDocument store to an implementation, and then later on, I can do something like the iDocument store, so I don't have to keep around all these class variables. It's just a little trick again. You don't have to use it. And the rest still kind of the same, yeah. Then I start a test server, and then I have a when. So wait a second, what did we start with? We started with when a document is activated here. That was the title. All the private fields are gone except of a GUID. Why? I am not really good at remembering GUIDs. You know, if I use a GUID at the beginning of the test, at the end of the test, I am not really that good at seeing if it's the same GUID. I'm lying, I'm actually pretty good at it, but probably because I'm a bit autistic, but in the end, doesn't matter. And then, so we have the given, where we set up the context, the when, where we execute, that represents what happens, the document is activated. And then we have a then, yeah, given, when, then. It should be included in the active count. Still a lot of noise, right? Still quite a lot of noise, yeah. And there's many steps, and if you go to GitHub, to the link is probably in the show notes or the presentation notes, you'll find all the intermediate steps explaining how I refactored it. I'll probably take one intermediate step is that, you know, so one of the things I did here in these tests, just the keyboard, is I'm still, I already switched it around, sorry, go back to the intermediate implementation, this one. Here I'm using these builders to change, but what I'm really doing here is hack directly into database and put some test data in there. That's what I'm doing. Then I'm executing my, I'm saying that state is transitioned, and then I do this HTTP request to see if the result is correct. But I'm still kind of going from the back, and I've been told you should not do that, going through the back. So I decided to do it a bit more cleaner by saying, you know what, now I'm going to actually simulate, and this one is much more refactored. So this is the test, when document is activated. I'm actually saying I'm going to simulate what really happens in a system, which is a country is registered, a contract is negotiated, a validity period is planned, a period is approved, and then a state transition event happens. So now I'm actually simulating what happens on this line all the way. So now I treat it as a gray box. It's not white box. I'm not directly going through the back. I'm doing it properly through the entry point it should be. But it's still quite a big test, I would say, yeah. And this one also has been refactored quite heavily. Because now you see, it's still, I mean, you still see the URL. Why? Because I think that URL is important. In this particular module, or a boundary if you call it, the URL is part of the contract. That's how other people, consumers, other parts of the system, interact with this module, through URL, because that's what REST does. So I show it, it's important. I still have to do get some response and it all looks ugly. And then I do something with like, okay, I'm thinking, I think I deserialize this JSON response into some type save object. That's what I'm doing here. That's why it's called expectation. And then I'm verifying using this method should to be equivalent to compare the two objects to see if it's correct. So I'm actually going through the right channels, but I still feel it's a bit, So let me do one more thing. I introduced a little bit of a language, and now I do this. When a contract is active, the given is a country was registered, a contract of kind filming in country was negotiated, the contract was approved. So I've actually built a little bit of a domain-specific language. It's a Fluent API. I love Fluent APIs for some reason. And then the when, and now it becomes much more clean. This one is still, yeah, I can't make it simpler than that. There's just too much stuff. But I'm actually now, if you look at this picture, I'm testing this whole box from left all the way. And of course, building this little contract, this Fluent API would be complete overkill. But just assume that in this particular case, because we're testing a domain, there will be like thousands of these tests. So it's worthwhile trying to show you the important things. Make sense? Okay. I think there's more versions, but you can look that up on GitHub if you really care. Go back. Yes, I did that. So a couple of things I've applied. Define the boundary carefully, obviously, that's really important. And this is where most people struggle if they practice TDD, trying to figure out what is the boundary. And the funny thing is, I would say if you don't know the boundary in your current system, if you don't know the internal seams in your architecture, you've probably built a monolith. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. But if you can't identify the seams, the monolith might internally be contain a lot of spaghetti code, I can imagine. So it's really important for your testing scope, for review scope to understand how you decouple things from each other. All of this is combined to the boundary, and then the boundary becomes a natural unit in your unit test. I've shown you two different styles, the range act assert, BDD. it's not like you have to choose one or the other. I typically see that state-based testing, you can look up that term, use more like the range act assert. Classes that you know test of the test that more test like an orchestration or thing, like the example that I showed you at the end, is usually using more like a BDD style. Yeah. Now, don't repeat the context in the name. I didn't show you that. But if every test starts with the same text, when querying, when the document, when the document, when the document, that doesn't help. It's just noise. Try to make it as concise and functional as possible. And don't use technical names. Don't use the name of a code construct in the name of your test. You will rename stuff, and then your tests are still using the old name. In fact, it should be functional. It should be written in the language of the business, ideally, or the language that's applicable, the ubiquitous language, if you've heard that term before. Avoid constants. I've shown you that. Use the test builder, test data builder, which is a nice little pattern. Show the relevant dependencies. So if you have a class that has a lot of dependencies, show them. They're part of the contract. Maybe not on every test, but maybe only in the first one. You show all the dependencies because if somebody, I know you know this thing about maximum three dependencies. Yeah, you don't want to hide that in your unit test by using some construct that will spin up a new instance of your class, create fakes automatically of all your dependencies. Don't do that. Make it explicit because it will pop up during your code review. And your tests are reviewed. I usually start reviewing the unit test before I actually review the actual underlying code because the unit test explained to me, hopefully, if they followed my advice, what this thing is trying to do. And only assert the relevant parts. If you're expecting an exception, don't start put the entire exception text message in your test. Who cares? Just verify that relevant parts are there. Why would a test fail if you just refine your exception message or your error message slightly? If the gist is still the same, and keep refactoring, yeah. And that one is nice. Keep out of the debugger hell. There's a guy in the .NET space called Jeremy D. Miller. He actually wrote this like 15 years ago. If you need to go into a debugger to figure out why your test is failing, you're doing something wrong. That's kind of my statement. It doesn't always work like that. I know I have also had my bad days, but it's a good like heuristic to try to follow. You know, it's not a bad thing. It just happens sometimes. But try to avoid it. Try to see if it happens again. Can you make your test more readable? Are the error messages not clear why it fails? Is the title not correct? All of this stuff is really important too. Yeah, that's kind of all the open doors I have for today. Any questions then?